what we see and what we seem are but a dream. A dream within a dream.
We see and what we seem are but a dream within a dream. These opening lines from Peter Weir's second feature film, Picnic at Hanging Rock, very poetically announced to the Australian public what we could expect from this very Australian auteur for the next four decades. Peter Weir would examine the protagonist's struggle to differentiate between what is reality and what is a dream many more times, along with many other themes of identity, culture and isolation. This microdoc will explore and identify those themes and other aspects of Peter Weir's body of work that recognises him as a leader of the Australian New Wave movement and clearly identifies him as one of our country's most important auteurs. Born in Sydney in 1944, Weir studied arts and law at the University of Sydney, where he began making short films with a collective known as Ubu Films. He dropped out and travelled around Europe before coming home heavily influenced by 1960s European cinema and with a strong opposition to the Vietnam conflict, a theme he would later explore in Gallipoli. The late 60s was a period of immense change in Australian society, culminating in Gough Whitlam's dismissal in 1975.
Because nothing will save the Governor-General.
It was also, however, a golden time for artists, as the government recognised the importance of filmmaking in its modern culture, and funding was made available. The time was right for a homegrown auteur to emerge. Weir took jobs with Channel 7 and Film Australia, which enabled him to continue making short films, before finding success with his short film Incredible Floridas, and steady work as a writer on the hugely successful Auntie Jack Show. In 1974, Weir wrote and directed his first full-length feature film, The Cars That Ate Paris. This was successful enough to enable Weir to get funding for his next project, Picnic at Hanging Rock. A major success within Australia, Weir then made The Last Wave in 1977, Gallipoli in 1981, and The Year of Living Dangerously in 1982. These last two films in particular found an international audience, and Weir was then able to begin his hugely successful overseas career, beginning with Witness in 1985. As mentioned earlier, in Weir's early films we see a common theme whereby the protagonist or protagonists are forced to question the reality of their situation, and this motif certainly followed into much of his later work as well. However, we may certainly see a common thread in all of his films where the isolation of his characters is the chief obstacle, be it physically, as in The Year of Living Dangerously, and later Master and Commander, culturally, as in The Last Wave, and later Witness, or even mentally, as in Picnic at Hanging Rock, and later The Truman Show. In confronting this isolation, it is often the recognition of the protagonist's own identity, cultural or personal, that enables them to begin to overcome this obstacle. Often Weir will leave the question hanging with the audience as to whether or not the protagonist was successful, with open-ended finales such as In the Last Wave and Picnic at Hanging Rock. My personal favourite among common themes of Weir's, and perhaps this arcs back to his TV days, is his contempt for commercialism. Watch this opening scene from The Cars That Ate Paris. This sequence was very similar to a Datsun car commercial that aired at that time. Weir then further questions society's fixation on material concepts in The Last Wave, Witness, and The Mosquito Coast, before taking it to its extreme in The Truman Show, as we see here.
Why don't you let me fix you some of this new mococo drink? All natural cocoa beans from the upper slopes of Mount Nicaragua, no artificial sweeteners.
What the hell are you talking about? Who are you talking to?
I've tasted other cocos. This is the best.
Another signature aspect of Weir's work is a very specific use of framing. Always in evidence, and often taking advantage of any natural edifice, virtually every one of his films set in modern times also has a shot from inside of a car. As we see here in his first film, The Cars That Ate Paris, then The Last Wave, The Year of Living Dangerously, The Mosquito Coast, The Truman Show, and Witness. In nearly every case, it is also this scene where the relationship between the two main characters ramps up to the next level of intimacy, shown beautifully here in Witness.
Don't know much about the French actor, but I do know that I love you. And I know that if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be. Don't know much about geography, don't know much trigonometry.
Some of Peter Weir's films incorporate a lot of establishing shots and long shots that present a view of the epic landscape and the character's journey. On the other hand, the contrasting elements between empty space and the character also gives a sense of isolation, as mentioned earlier. In this case, it also portrays the character's loneliness and despair. The character is also one of the most important things in his films. Peter Weir often uses optimistic characters that will stop at nothing to achieve their goal.
You're wrong. Now, if you crouch down, you've got further to go to get up.
Try it. First to the pyramids.
Okay, you're on.
In The Way Back, we could see the struggle as Janusz and his friends try to escape Siberia through the rough mountain terrain and the vast desert that seems to be impossible to pass.
Do you think we'll get there by tonight?
So things are.
The thing that makes this interesting is their unburdened spirit and optimism to achieve their goal.
It's a passing storm.
No, it's enough.
Yaros, that is impossible. We need detailed preparation. We need plans. We need maps.
The timing will never be perfect. Look at
them. Aside from the beautiful story and cinematographic composition, Peter Weir utilizes various pieces of music to create emotion and build tension in his films. Unlike other film directors who prefer to collaborate with a certain film score composer, Peter Weir chooses to use pre-composed music to drive the story forward. There is no particular theme song for his films. He mainly incorporates some pieces of classical music such as Symphony No. 9 by Beethoven, String Quartet No. 1 by Tchaikovsky, and Beethoven's Piano Concerto No. 5, along with other contemporary music instead of scores made specifically for his films. The way he puts music on the film reflects the character's mood and emotion. It is often played during the strongest point of a sequence, which evokes the overall tone of the scene. The music itself is subtly placed in the background and does not draw too much attention, but is powerful enough to subconsciously change the audience's perception towards certain emotions within the scene.
Ready? Set? Go!
Within the delicately woven screenplays, Weir also uses music to bring anticipation to a scene and also to link the separate scenes together, as in Gallipoli, every time one of the two protagonists are running. The opening credits of Weir's 1975 film, Picnic at Hanging Rock, alludes to the strange occurrences to follow within the deep and eerie soundscape of the wind until after the opening title fades. The sound appears throughout the film, seamlessly blending into the score, which together with the diegetic sound brings each scene to life and creates the mysterious tone of the film. Although this may seem like an obvious stylistic technique, Peter Weir's films always deliver an enveloping storyline with a score and soundtrack to match. This is something that definitely establishes him as an auteur.
Captain, my captain.
Sit down, Mr. Anderson. You hear me? Sit down.
It has been said that Weir is dominantly concerned with the juxtaposition of cultures, Last Wave, Witness, European arthouse characteristics within the genre conventions of each of his films, and of course, alternative realities. He expresses his intrigue for the dream aspect and the alternative perceptions, specifically the dream time and its links to mythology, in an interview about the making of his 1977 film, The Last Wave. But it's not his interest in the dream world or his consistent trend in creating contemporary films that make him an auteur in my eyes. It is his determination in creating authenticity and finding truth within each of his stories. Weir insisted that real tribal First Nations people play the parts of the tribal characters in the film, so he travelled far to meet with magistrate and tribesman Nandijwara Amagala, seeking him to play the role of Charlie. Fortunately, Nandi, as he was known, agreed, and gave permission for the other tribal men to be a part of the film, as long as one thing was made clear on their end, the law was above all. Weir, not wanting to lose his authentic tribesmen, made sure their lines were cleared by them. He even wrote part of his own conversation with Nandi into the dinner scene, just to reiterate the fact. Although these were completely fictitious characters, although no tribes are still left in Sydney, Weir created an amazingly real performance by striving for a sense of truthfulness. This determination in delivering the story as authentically as possible to his imagined reality can be seen, if not felt even, when watching one of his films. This is something that seems to be consistent within Weir's career, and is the reason I view him as a great Australian auteur. Before the making of Picnic at Hanging Rock, Weir was asked to get permission of Joan Lindsay, author of the 1967 novel of the same name, to make the film. Weir said he had to ask the question he'd been told not to ask: is the story true? He didn't get the answer he was looking for, but what he did get was enough for him to make the film his own. In another interview with the established director, he talks about the process in finding the story of Gallipoli. He originally wanted to make a war film, but believed that a film about the Anzacs would be too reminiscent of the parades and assemblies at school. It wasn't until Weir travelled to Turkey himself that he knew he had to make the film. It was later still, while researching Australia's official war history, that he found the words that would make his film one to remember. This passage, describing Wilfred Harper of the 10th Light Horse during the attack at the Neck, was what inspired yet another beautiful character and story from Weir. Wilfred was last seen running forward like a schoolboy in a foot race, with all the speed he could compass. Thank you.